Penguin Random House Audio presents Secrets of the Flesh, A Life of Colette by Judith Thurman. Read for you by Cassandra Campbell. When my body thinks, all my flesh has a soul. Colette, Retreat from Love. Introduction. Biographers generally believe that it is easy to be a monster. It is even harder than being a saint. Colette. Lettres à ses pères. In March of 1900, a 41-year-old Parisian man of letters published a novel that purported to be the journal of a 16-year-old provincial schoolgirl named Claudine. Henri Gauthier-Villars was best known as an amusingly opinionated music critic who had championed Wagner and insulted Satie. His paunch and top hat had endeared him to the cartoonists of the penny press, and his duels, his puns, and his seductions of women managed to generate almost as much copy as he wrote himself. Gauthier-Villars used his own name for scholarly nonfiction and one of many pseudonyms when a work was light. He and his alter egos, Willie, Jim Smiley, Boris Zikin, Henry Mogi, and the Usherette, had a bibliography which already included a collection of sonnets, another of essays on photography, several comic almanacs, a monograph on Mark Twain, and a number of salacious popular novels. It was not a very well-kept secret that most of these works had been improved by other hands, if not entirely ghostwritten. In an ironic bow to this reputation, Willie claimed that the new manuscript had arrived in the mail tied with a pink ribbon, the literary equivalent of a baby girl delivered by the stork. Claudine at School was not the first authorial travesty of its kind, and certainly not the last, although Claudine herself was something new. She was the century's first teenage girl. Rebellious, tough-talking, secretive, erotically reckless and disturbed, by turns beguiled and disgusted at her discovery of what it means to become a woman. In his preface to the book, Willie calls her a child of nature, a Tahitian before the advent of the missionaries, and he pays homage to her innocent perversity, even while regretting this word perversity, which subverts the idea that I wish to give of Claudine's special case. For the very reason that I insist one cannot find any conscious vice in this young girl, who is, one might say, less immoral than she is amoral. The novel languished for a few months until Willie rallied his influential friends, who duly produced reviews hailing Claudine at School as a masterpiece. By autumn, it had sold some 40,000 copies, becoming, including its four sequels, one of the greatest French bestsellers of all time. There were five Claudines in all, two successful plays and a range of product spin-offs in the modern sense, including Claudine cigarettes, perfume, chocolates, cosmetics, and clothing. The author, notorious to begin with, became something of a brand himself. I think that only God and maybe Alfred Dreyfus are as famous as Willie, said Sacha Guitry. The man who signed Claudine at School is now best remembered as the deplorable first husband of the woman who wrote it. Madame Henri Gauthier-Villars, née Sidonie Gabrielle Colette, was then an athletic beauty of 27 who could pass easily for 17. She concealed her feelings and her talent, but she flaunted her rustic accent and a plait of auburn hair as long as she was tall. Her family in Burgundy still called her Gabri, but in Paris she went by the waifish moniker of Colette Willie. She had rejected her own first name long before she married, insisting that her school friends, rowdy village girls like herself and like Claudine, call one another by their patronyms, comme des garçons. When she married for the second time, Colette Willie became Colette de Juvenel, and finally, triumphantly, syncretically, just Colette. Colette began writing in her early 20s, living turbulently and working tirelessly, her powers waxing as she aged. In the course of half a century, she produced nearly 80 volumes of fiction, memoirs, journalism, and drama of the highest quality. Her published correspondence fills 7 volumes, and at least 3 important collections of letters remain unedited. Her critics and biographers have been more prolific than she was. Digesting this colossal banquet was not the greatest of my challenges as her biographer. Colette's friend Jean Cocteau liked to say, "Je suis un mensonge que dit toujours la vérité." I am a lie that always speaks the truth. To which Colette's American anthologist, Robert Phelps, would add, "She is a truth who always speaks a lie." A French critic would note more expansively, "Colette's art is that of the lie, but the great game she plays with us is precisely to stuff her best lies with great flashes of truth." To read her with pleasure thus consists of disentangling, with a deft pair of tweezers, the true from the false. The autobiographical candor of Colette's best writing is an illusion, just as her celebrated physical immodesty is misleading. She has, as Dominique Ory puts it, a fierce modesty of sentiment. She actively disdains all forms of empathy and resists being known. My title, Secrets of the Flesh, comes from a fan letter which André Gide sent Colette after reading Cherie. "What a wonderful subject you have taken up, and with what intelligence, mastery, and understanding of the least admitted secrets of the flesh." It's darker in the French. Des secrets les moins avoués de la chair. And I recognize it as the kind of compliment that is more significant for the envy and unease with which Gide makes it. Secrets of the Flesh sounds rather louche, and that, of course, is intentional. My own ironic bow to Colette's reputation. Her novels were locked away from young French women of good families and put on the Vatican's index of proscribed texts. Simone de Beauvoir had to read Colette for the first time on the sidewalk outside a Paris bookstore. The critics called Colette soulless and perverse, reproaching her for an art based solely on the senses. Even Colette's lover, the Marquise de Morny, a lesbian, transvestite, and former drug addict, would complain of her to Willie, "Colette is an impulsive child without any moral feeling." The child, who was 33 at the time, was amused rather than defensive. "I was quite surprised," she told Willie, "to see the words moral feeling in Missy's handwriting." Some of the condescension that the world reserves for the acting profession, a bias against its perceived narcissism, has also rubbed off on Colette, who, as a young woman, acted and mimed on the music hall stage, sometimes half-nude, sometimes in drag. She played a gypsy, a gigolo, and a cat, a faun in a torn chamois loincloth, and an Egyptian mummy who comes back from the dead in a jeweled bra. Every time in later life that her name was proposed for some official honor, a chorus of elders protested. This fallen young Colette, in the prime of her beauty, was as attractive to potential saviors as she was to libertines of both sexes. The monkish poet Francis Jammes offered to play Jesus to her unrepentant Magdalene. The priestly François Mauriac would later give her unsolicited absolution for her sins of the flesh, claiming that this pagan and carnal creature leads us irresistibly to God. How? By offering, in characters like Leah and Cherie, such a desolate example of hedonism unredeemed by any higher spiritual aspirations. I'm not sure that many readers have fled in disgust from Colette to God, and it could be that a fair number have turned with relief from him to her. But Mauriac isn't wrong about Colette's existential pessimism. Senses, inretractable masters, as ignorant as the princes of old who learned only what was indispensable, to dissimulate, to hate, to command. Like her mother, Sido, who claimed that she had been born 300 years too early for the world to understand her, Colette was an anachronism in her own generation. "O bourgeoisie of 1880, she exclaims almost 60 years later, "idle and cloistered young girls, sweet-tempered cattle ruled by men, incurable feminine solitude, ignoble resignation. The young adolescent generation of 1937 looks upon you with incredulity. What we look upon with incredulity in 1999 is Colette's invention of the modern teenager in 1895, when she began to write Claudine at school. She was not a sweet-tempered cow. She thought she wanted to be ruled by a man, but she hated her dependence and marginality.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.